Simon & Schuster Audio Works presents Strangers from the Sky by Margaret Wander Bonanno, one of a series of Star Trek audio programs. Strangers from the Sky is read by George Takei, with Leonard Nimoy as the voice of Spock.
Leonard McCoy was lost in the 21st century. Not that he minded especially. He'd gotten himself stuck between the pages of a history book he now found he couldn't put down. Like most humans, McCoy had thought he knew all about how the Vulcans first came to Earth. But that was before he read Strangers from the Sky. The author's foreword gave some clue as to what was to come. Every Federation schoolchild knows that Earthmen's first encounter with alien life was the result of an Earth ship's mission to Alpha Centauri in the year 2048. The establishment of peaceful relations between these two safely humanoid worlds made it easy for Terrans to overcome any residual fears of little green men. The first encounter with Vulcans, according to official sources, came about nearly 20 years later, when the Earthship Amity rescued a disabled Vulcan craft adrift inside the solar system in 2065. Despite vast philosophical and cultural differences and the simple strangeness of this non-human race, the encounter with the Centaurians nearly two decades before made it possible for Earthmen to free themselves of prejudice and fear. The alliance between Earth and Vulcan has remained virtually untroubled since. The facts are all readily available to us in history tapes and the Amity's ship's log. Yet another self-congratulatory example of how human altruism reached across the barriers of difference to offer the hand of friendship. Except that it didn't happen that way at all.
It began on a seaweed farm in the South Pacific. In the sleeping room of the agronomy station, perched on its mid-ocean platform in the center of acres of undulating kelp, Tatya sat up in bed and watched a strange orange glow arc across the royal blue bowl of night sky. She threw her heavy blonde braids back over her shoulders and gave Yoshi a poke. Yoshi, something's going down out there. Look. He groaned, dragged his long, skinny self reluctantly out from under the warm covers, and stared out the window port. It's a meteor, he said finally, dismissing it, diving back into bed. No, it's not, Tatya said, certain of it. It's moving steadily, not tumbling, like it's on a set course. It has to be a spacecraft. We sent a ship to Alpha Centauri looking for intelligent life. What if it's come to us? What if... But Yoshi was already snoring softly. Tatya was the first to spot the wreck bobbing on the surface the next morning. She and Yoshi were out in the hydrofoil checking the crops. Cut power! Tatya yelled over the motor, pointing off to starboard as the hydrofoil settled into the water. There! It was definitely a spacecraft. There were many in use throughout the solar system, including a ferry that made the run between Earth, the moon bases, and the recent colonies on Mars. But it's not an Earth ship, Tatya said, studying the alien shape of it. The damaged spacecraft began to yaw violently as soon as Tatya lowered herself inside, settling dangerously low in the water. Tatya, Yoshi called down to her. You're taking on a lot of water. What do you see? There were four passengers altogether, two aft or dead. The other two are still strapped in their seats, unconscious but alive. Yoshi heard her sloshing through knee-deep water. On? I can't find a pulse on either of them. Rig the stretcher. I'm going to start sending them up. Then? Who? Yoshi said, scrambling to rig the rescue harness, but scanning the horizon at the same time. They couldn't have been the only ones who'd seen the ship go down. Little green men, Tatya? Who? He saw her pale, concerned face in the darkness below. I'm not sure. You have any relatives on Mars? First Mate Melody Sawyer of the seagoing aeronav ship Delphinus handed Captain Nayere a cup of coffee. The communication screen crackled and bleeped, message coming through. The message was from aeronav control itself. Jason, Melody Sawyer said when the communique from command was finished. What is Regulation 2013? 2013, Captain Nayere said, dabbing perspiration from his face, is a contingency plan for possible alien invasion. Melody laughed out loud. We're looking for a flying saucer? I don't believe it. Jason nodded dismally. Believe it. What if it was that went down out there last night, Melody? It wasn't one of ours. We're to have a long, considered look at it and report our findings to Command. Command then decides if Old Earth is ready to know for an absolute certainty that there is intelligent life on other worlds. Melody swallowed hard.
And if Command decides no?
Then it falls to us to make certain that whoever or whatever we find out there and any witnesses to their arrival. Jason shook his head, unbelieving. Cease to exist. Relatives on Mars, Tutcha had said. At first glance, the young man on the stretcher did look like a distant cousin, Yoshi thought, except for the ears and the slanting eyebrows. He moved Tutcha's unconscious patient off the stretcher onto one of the bunks below. The water level was rising dangerously. There was no time to waste. Yoshi lowered the stretcher a second time and heard Tutcha shout,
"This one smashed your face to hell. I want to warn you. I know how you feel about blood."
Before he could answer, the foundering craft tilted suddenly, snapping the hawser, securing it to the hydrofoil, and knocking Yoshi over. The craft lurched and spun. Water poured into the open hatch. There was barely time to shove the stretcher onto the deck and haul a drenched and gasping Tutcha upstream to safety. In an instant, it was over. The sea was calm, and the spacecraft might never have been. Yoshi steered the hydrofoil for home, and Tutcha went to examine her patients for the first time in daylight. She'd expected blood, but...
My God! It's green!
Destruction before detection. It was the axiom etched on every Vulcan scout craft commander's soul. When the very first craft was sent to observe the first populated world some 170.15 years before, the prefect for off-world affairs had decreed its necessity. It is our purpose to study these worlds with a view toward a time when first contact is deemed practicable without giving any evidence that we ourselves exist, Prefect Savar had written. For that reason, any craft disabled within an inhabited system must self-destruct before its presence is discovered. Destruction before detection. It was the first application of the Vulcan Prime Directive. Commander Telera, daughter of the same Prefect Savar, was the first to act upon it. Destruction before detection. It seemed to Telera she had ingested the concept with her mother's milk. A commander accepts the responsibility for the lives of all her crew, whether blood relatives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.